sign of the times. Corporate police state. Welcome to the video. It just inadvertently came to my attention. Something was like, wow, a real epiphany. This president of the PGA of America, you know, it's a real bigwig, like Bishop something, I don't know his name, but Joe Bishop or something. He just got fired. It's like, boom, instantly fired. It was very interesting. I started thinking about this, and I realized in my life, I could have been anyone in this world, actually. From a president to a pope to a CEO to any position, any high position, is not a problem. But the Holy Spirit said, no. Don't waste your time. And I said, well, what do you mean? I can help a lot of people. No. You trust in me, the Holy Spirit said, trust. So I said, okay, it's difficult because I see all these people in high positions, and I said, I can do better than they're doing for sure. And it's very frustrating. But the Holy Spirit said, no, spiritual path, don't worry about that stuff. Don't lay your treasures up in this world. So, okay. So I've taken the spiritual path. I'm committed to it. That's great. Now I'm looking at these situations that are happening in the world. I said, how did this really bigwig, very connected bigwig, you know, as a WASP, a white Anglo-Saxon Protestant, I would imagine. And he got instantly fired for calling this British golfer, Ian Poulter. He's a very good golfer, real, but very sort of, he has his own style, okay? I got no problem with him. But he's mouthing off, and golf is very stuffy, and certain things you don't say and stuff. And so the bishop said, he said, stop acting like a little girl. You know, in other words, stop whining. He could have said whining, but he used a little term to, you know, jab Poulter. And, okay. It's just a little, you know, just some spat there, you know. Instantly fired for that. It's like, what? Now, when's the last time you saw a woman get fired for anything, actually? I mean, they could be a big, in the you know, administration of the president, they could like do stuff that's like incredibly terrible. And they go, well, maybe they finally might apologize or something. Everyone says, oh, okay. I mean, this guy apologized immediately. Doesn't matter. Instantly fired. White male, instantly fired. And I said, wow. I was thinking, you know, I bet you there's a whole lot of white males in positions of heads of CEOs and businesses and important bureaucratic positions. I bet you they're all like sleeping really poorly these days. And in the front of their mind and the back of their mind, there's this feeling, you know what? One of these days, for sure, I'm going to say something and I'm going to be instantly fired for it, without question. And I said, yeah, you know, that's true. What they're doing now, the corporation is getting spokeswomen to say everything for the corporation. Don't even have the man speak at all. Because women can say anything at all, doesn't make any difference. So can anybody except white males can say anything they want. And so they hire these spokespersons, and they're the ones who speak for the corporation. Now, what is going to happen? You can write it down now. Okay. Is that the corporations are going to take preemptive steps. The board of directors, okay, which represent the stockholders, are going to say, you know what? We can't afford any bad publicity in today's world at all. And we got this white male, you know, CEO. And for sure, at some point, he's going to say something that is going to guillotine him. You know, send him to the guillotine instantly. No trial, anything. And that's going to make our corporation look terrible. So they're going to say, what they're going to say is, let's take preemptive steps, everybody, here. And let's put women in charge of CEOs and get rid of all the white males. And therefore, we won't have any of this bad publicity happening at all. You see, they can say anything. And everyone just says, oh, that's great. They're just asserting themselves. This is what's going to happen. This is what's going to happen. This is what I saw. And then I remember the Holy Spirit saying, don't even think about it. Don't even think about it. I said, oh my God. Thank you, Holy Spirit. I didn't waste all my time, you see. Because I would have been one of those CEOs or, you know, high position And I would be in the exact same position as all these rest of these white males. Basically, we can't have you around anymore. Okay? So, now, who's my boss? Who's my boss? Jesus is my boss. Okay. So, for me, I say to anybody, you want me fired? Go talk to Jesus. Go right now. I got no worries. Go ahead. Tell him if you want me fired. And of course, what they did was they said, "Well, we'll get the Virgin Mary to go talk to Jesus and get you fired. Because, see, Jesus won't fire you, but she can convince him to fire you." I said, "Go ahead, then. Go talk to the Virgin Mary and tell her to get me fired through Jesus. Go ahead. I got no worries about that." You know, here Jesus is our brother who said in Journey Beyond Words, there's no such thing as accountability. There's no guilt, there's no sin, there's no such thing as accountability. We are all absolutely perfectly free, every moment, always. Everything that happens is because our desire that it happens to us, without exception. There is no such thing as accountability. So you really think that Jesus is going to fire me? You know? He's not. So, but, you know, I'm not trying to antagonize anybody. I'm just pointing out the situation as it is. And like I said, corporate princess culture is in charge of this world. The rebellious spirits have come to this planet. And they realize that the woman is, they've done all the studies, all these corporations, they found that they're way more materialistically consumer-oriented. The dollars, really, the expenditures go through them. So they want them to be in charge of this corporate princess culture that they are instituting in this world. They want the men out, absolutely. So they ring booby trap this whole situation through the social media and through all these politically correct saboteurs, really, to bring out this dynamic now where they're going to be proactive and say, you know what, board of directors will say, we want a woman in there, it's safer for our PR. Plain and simple. They've already taken the step of firewalling the whole corporation with women spokespersons. And more you see that, is that the whole face of society is now in the hands of women, actually. You might see the presence that he is right at this moment, actually, in a lot of ways. But, and you can go to Jesus and get me fired for that if you want to, but he won't fire me. Now, we understand that the rebellious spirits have come to this planet. That's what we were told is going to happen. It's happened. And the booby trap, the whole thing, it's happened. So I didn't waste my life pursuing some high position in society. You see, the Holy Spirit said, no, that's going to be a huge problem later on. So I spent my time on the spiritual path. Now, these guys that are living in dread right now, they need to get on the spiritual path, is what they need. And stop, don't put your faith in this world, any position in this world, don't you put your faith in it. Don't put your faith in it. Work for Jesus, okay? Work for the boss, you know? Work for your brother who's free of delusion. And he won't fire you. He's not going to fire you. He's not going to put you down. He's not going to say you're terrible, you know? He's not PC. Jesus is not PC, believe me. Because I've said a whole lot of stuff in my life and he's never fired me, you know? But not mean-spirited, you know? Even if I was mean-spirited, he wouldn't fire me, but certainly not politically correct at all. I'm the least politically correct person you're ever going to find, really. But just telling it as it is, telling it like it is. But there's, wow, a big old huge crow just suddenly flew in and landed right on a branch here. Hey, crow. Whatever. Yeah. Darkness flying in is one way to interpret it. So, certainly we get intimidated. The idea that somehow someone can intercede with Jesus and change his mind is one of the ways that the goddess, the princess, corporate princess culture intimidates everybody, okay? Because we think, oh, Jesus has saved us. We know we can rely on Jesus. And then we're told, oh, no, but the goddess can change his mind. If we pray enough, pray to her and sacrifice to her and enslave ourselves to the goddess enough, she can go and change Jesus' mind and get us fired. And so we say, oh, wow, I better appease the goddess, you know, so I don't get fired, so Jesus doesn't fire me, because she doesn't go to Jesus and say, I want to be fired. This is one of the central stumbling blocks I've discovered. I went through this. I was thinking, like, wow, maybe I'm going to get in big trouble with this PC culture, as it's been developing the last 30 years very strongly, for the last 40 years or so, even 50. And I saw it, of course, and it's just been completely blatantly obvious. I saw what's happening, and I warned everybody. I said, wow, you know, I'm telling you what's going to happen. And it's you know, it's gender enslavement. Men are being enslaved. There's no question about it. They're going to lose their jobs, their position, their authority. They're eventually going to be preemptively removed. And this is what's happening, because the corporations can't trust them as much as they can trust women. It's very simple. Corporations want things to run smoothly, you know, board of directors, stockholders, they want the profits to be smooth, they want everybody committed to their product, their brand, their ideology, they want everybody to be happily brainwashed, okay, and men tend to be a little cranky about that, and get these ideas like maybe they want to listen to Jesus, you know, and so corporations found out that women are more easily, you know, brought into line with corporate consumerism, not all of them, of course, but the, you know, percentage-wise, they're playing the percentages, okay? So we have to talk about it, understanding they're playing the percentages. Playing it safe, playing the percentages. And they're very good at what they do. They've figured it out very carefully. And the stumbling block I had over the last 30 years is this fear, like maybe the goddess can change Jesus' mind or something, you know, influence him in some way. In fact, the goddess, I remember a dream I had where she came to me and that Jesus was there. I saw Jesus and the goddess said, oh yeah, I work for him. I work for Jesus. We're co-redeemers. And we work together and we make joint decisions on everything. And I said, whoa, wow, really? Well, maybe I better get on your good side then. You know, this is the lie. This is the deception that hooked me and caused me great problems. Nobody influences Jesus. Okay. He doesn't need someone to talk to just make a decision. I'm not sure what to do here. You know, can you give me some input, goddess, and can you help establish truth for me? I'm not really clear about truth and stuff. Not true at all. There's no quote-unquote co-redeemerness with the goddess at all. Okay, that's a corporate princess culture deception of the rebellious ones. Okay, Jesus is 100% clear that there's no such thing as sin, there's no such thing as guilt, there's no such thing as accountability, there's no such thing as determinism, this world has absolutely no value. He's completely clear about all this, and there's no exceptions or exemptions for this whatsoever. So you can't have somebody going to Jesus and say, hey Jesus, you need to make an exception for this guy, you need to fire him because he's actually does have determinism in his makeup, and no, or we just don't like him, so you gotta make an exemption and say truth isn't truth for him, true for him. Forget it, Jesus is not going to do that whatsoever. Take that to the bank. That would be a lie. If Jesus believed that, he would lose his own clarity and fall into confusion, which he's not going to do. So it's worthwhile to look at all this, because I know that there are a lot of people in the world who, I mean, I've spoken to some white men, males in high school, going to high school at the time, and they told me, says, you can't believe how scared we all are. He says, we don't dare do anything that upsets women anyway, and we don't even know what could upset them, because if we do, you know, our lives are ruined, essentially. You know, this is in high school, and this was like 15 years ago or so. And they said, we're all living in fear. And the more I talk to men, the more I realize that if they'll open up, they'll say, we live in terrible fear, terrible fear. Anything we say can just be used as you know, this is worse than any kangaroo court that any banana republic ever put up. It's intentional to strip the white males especially, of all authority, but males in general, so this corporate princess culture can seize total control of this planet and make sure that nobody really truly listens to Jesus, listens to truth, listens to the Holy Spirit again, ever. And those who do are considered criminal. You know, line the pockets of the shareholders of all these corporations. So, as I got these clarity, more and more clarity of what's going on in the world, I got more and more worried, saying, wow, this is horrible what's taking place. It's terrible. And I know about it, and what if people realize I know about it? I'm going to get in severe problems. I mean, the goddess is going to ask for my head, you know. And she said that she has influence over Jesus. That's what I was told, you know, which was a total blatant lie, but it scared me so bad at the time that I ended up trying to please the goddess. She's thinking that she, if I don't, she's going to ask for my head. You know, vicious, vicious lie, to say the least. So we have to counter that. The goddess has zero influence on Jesus. Zero. Never has had any influence, never will have any influence. Not one iota of influence on Jesus whatsoever, nor on truth whatsoever. Zero influence. Lies have no influence on truth. None. So take the path that Jesus is showing you, and don't be afraid that he's going to fire you. Suddenly he's going to turn on you, and the goddess will have convinced him that you're wicked because you're interfering with the corporate princess culture somehow and showing them the path to salvation. And then Jesus is going to say to you, is Jesus ever going to say, oh, yeah, well, God has told me you're bad, so I think I'm going to dump you? I said, but Jesus, I'm making my way very quickly towards the salvation you point out to me. Is Jesus going to say, yeah, I know, but the goddess doesn't like you, so I think I'm going to block you and pull the rug out from underneath you and, you know, and throw you to the wolves? Does anyone really think Jesus is going to say that? This is what the corporate princess culture is saying that Jesus will say. They have their own image of Jesus. They're going to teach people and tell people a new world religion, which is basically to say, if you say anything that offends the new ideology, they're using these women as professional offenders. You know, oh, I'm offended, which is really just they're speaking spokespersons for the corporate princess culture, secular humanistic materialism. And they'll say, if you say any of that stuff, you know, it's like, oh wow, you deserve to be enslaved. This is the future. This is the future that we're going towards. So I've tried to tell men, hey, you know, and women too, who wants to live in such a madhouse, really? Spend all your time, you know, pouring out for, you know, princess corporate culture, ignoring the spiritual path. That's not good for anybody, is it? It's not good for anyone. It's not good for anyone. So, constant stream of men simply saying something that any other man and most women would just shrug off. Well, most men. Some are so far down the rabbit hole that their professional offenders, the professional, what do you call it, agitators. Oh, that offended me. I'm so offended. But anyway, it's not offensive at all. I mean, and even if it was, so what? You know, it's ridiculous to chop someone's head off for that. Are you kidding? It's absolutely insane. Madness. And so everybody's feeling this. Everybody's feeling it. There's just some thinking that they need to, that they're desperately trying to kowtow to the corporate princess culture and the spokeswomen and say, oh yeah, you're incredible, you're great, you can do no wrong. You know, you have to say that. You say, you're like perfect, you're perfect. Yes, dear, you're perfect. Not a flaw. Everything you say is exactly right. Oh, there's no salvation. Oh, you're exactly right. Oh, you can intercede with Jesus. Oh, of course you're right. You know, this is the toadiness. Men are becoming slaves. They're being toady slaves. The whole culture is. And it's tragic, right? It's absolutely tragic. Now, of course, the holdouts are the Protestants. Because they got rid of the Virgin Mary, and they said, hey, there's no intercessor with Jesus. There's nobody who can change his mind. We we don't need a co-redemptrix with Jesus. So, you know, the Protestants are more resistant to this nonsense. They tend to be. They tend to feel like that there's nobody has any influence with Jesus. Okay, so if you're aligning with Jesus, you're fine. Don't worry, no worries. And so they remain like the holdouts, you know, and so they're being now sabotaged by their positions of authority and power in society. Are now they're going to be preemptively removed from all positions of power and authority so as to prevent any negative publicity. And of course, the whole press and media is all in on this. Their job is to, any little thing happens to a white male, it's like global headlines for a month, you know. Some white males protecting law and order, global headlines for a month if they have to defend law and order some way. So the press is all, they're saboteurs also, actually. They're part of they work for the corporate princess culture. They work for them, they're employed by them. This is their job, to be saboteurs and create this huge media firestorm, which by social media now has created, you know, a million times more intense. That's their job. And so, if you're one of the ones that's meant to be taken down, you know, they're gonna take you down. And then they're gonna say, hey, you know, we're gonna destroy your brand if anything happens like this, and then they'll say, oh, better get a woman in there, because then there's no firestorm at all. The media has orders to lay off. They got their orders for sure. This is all tacitly understood at a subconscious level, too. People say, where's the conspiracy? Where's the emails? No, it's all tacitly understood at the psychic level, you see. It's all understood at the psychic level, all this stuff. All the agreements are there. So, the Holy Spirit's right. Yeah, the Holy Spirit foresaw these times correctly, absolutely. I guarantee you, 50 years ago, nobody would say that's possible. That's crazy. It's absolutely ridiculous. And now, ridiculous is now happening. Then, I would say the next wave coming along probably is you know, this tremendous turnover in CEOs and business world, too, is coming. It's already coming in politics in every way possible. It's coming. Get the men out as fast as possible. Show them the door as fast as possible. When, I don't know, maybe Pope Benedict, you know, he was shown the door somehow, really, right? That's possible. Maybe what he was saying was offending the corporate princess culture so much, they forced him out in some way. Very possible. And got someone who's very simpatico with the whole secular humanist liberal corporate princess culture, which is Pope Francis, very simpatico with it. Interesting. And of course, well, the U.S. has a president who basically his administration is largely run by women. And he just says, yes, dear, yes, dear, yes, dear, basically, and goes along with it all. You know, basically goes out and plays golf. I mean, I'm sure he's not thrilled by it. You know, he's just being used. So he hits the golf course, you know. They say that those who can, they do, and those who can't, they play golf. So it's a pretty good sign that he doesn't have really the power that he thought he had. So you project all your troubles on the golf course and try to make some pars and birdies, and then you can feel good about yourself, you know, and say, oh, yeah, I defeated the troubles. It's just symbolizes, the golf course symbolizes the troubles of the world. And if you can't really solve those problems, you go out on the golf course and play golf. Also, if you're giving up on the world and realize you don't need to solve any of the problems, you might also go out and play golf, just for fun. Not worry about it. That also is possible. Crow is gone now. Didn't really pay any attention to the crow. So this is what's really happening in the world, and I think everybody knows it, and they're not able to enunciate it and express it because they think they'll get fired, for sure. I mean, saying this kind of stuff, if I was employed by the government and they found out this website, do you think I would last 1 second in any government post in the world? Not even 1 second. Any civil service job, not even 1 second. Any state job, not even a second would I last. If I was a head of any company, would that last? No, they'd chop the head off of that instantly, you see. So people are just frightened to say anything, terrified to say anything. So they don't say anything, and then that's used as evidence that there's nothing there to talk about. You see the duplicity of this world. Isn't it quote-unquote wonderful? Isn't it marvelous? Isn't it marvelous how clever we have been? It's a sign of our creativity that we're able to seemingly entrap ourselves. But you just keep in mind that Jesus will not fire us, you see. Even those who say he will, he won't even fire them. He's just waiting. He's just, come on. Get on the path. Get into phase one here. Get into phase two. Get into phase three. Come on. Get into phase four. But still, there's still this overall terror in the world. I mean, the real terrorists are these politically correct folks. That's the terrorism in the world. The worst by a million times worse. And they're terrorizing everybody's life. As you go anywhere you go, you, like for a white male, you're watching everything you say, everything you do, and thinking, can I get arrested for this? Can I get in trouble? Can I get fired? Can my life be ruined because of this? And you're so nice, and you might see something. Like, I see stuff all the time. I want to speak up. I say, no, you can't do that. Someone might take it the wrong way. They might get offended. They're going to file a complaint. Nobody is safe anymore from this politically correct terrorism. But there's no such thing in the supernature of Jesus. There's no such thing as that at all. Nothing's threatened. There's no way to threaten. Nature is not threatened. Your home is not threatened. So there's no thin skin at all. There's no instability at all. There's no insecurity at all. There's no point to that, any of that, really, one way or the other. But more to the point, Jesus isn't going to fire me, you see. He isn't going to fire me. Who has influence over Jesus? No one. No one. Those who truly realize nobody has influence on them, they know the truth. They abide in the truth. Nobody can come and tell them the truth isn't true. They won't believe him. Same with Longchenpa. Longchenpa came to help me. Did he refuse to help me because I'm not politically correct or something? No. He's not worried about that. But nobody's really politically correct. We all realize this is all a scam, and we're just have a continuity fear, so we're going along with these rebellious spirits that have come here to sabotage this world. Because we're too frightened. We're too frightened of success is the problem. So I know Jesus knows. I know that the real fear is fear of success. It's the fear of dropping this dream of indeterminism and realize the absolute perfection of all that is. All is completely perfect, always has been. We're afraid of that success, so that's why we cling to this nonsense. That's all understood. But certainly, who wants to walk around feeling that they're seen as inherently a criminal, inherently just a matter of time before they descend to the guillotine? That's really the feeling in the world. It's just a matter of time before we're sent to the guillotine. Who wants to walk around with that burden on their shoulders here? And the whole substitutionary thing, there's one of the ways that this Jesus thing as being a substitute came about is in ancient times, there's wars, constant wars. And there would be a war leader, the king, the war leader, was like the head of the army. army, the war effort, really. They're all like a deity, actually. Kings, great warlords are viewed as deities. Without the head of it, the army collapses. There's no more war. So what happened was, when they had these terrible conflicts between the various air regions and tribal regions and stuff, really awful stuff would take place. And you reach a certain point where one army would gain control and the other army was trapped. And what they'd do was they'd say, hey, the army, listen. Instead of us killing everybody, all your women and children, just raising the countryside, destroying everything, I'll tell you what, you send the king over to us and we will torture the king. So they tortured him first and then they killed him. And then we'll call it even. Okay. Because they knew that without this king, that's it. And, okay, the resistance would end. And then they would then absorb that kingdom into their kingdom and put their rulers in place and things, life would go on. This is how it worked. So the Jesus situation is very similar to that. It comes from this ancient system of let's minimize the damage to society by sacrificing the king, okay? So keep in mind at that time that the revolts against Rome were very much in place. All sorts of sporadic revolts, and even during Jesus' time, before Jesus' time, the Maccabean revolt was 70 AD or something like that, and then the Bar Kokhba revolt was 120, blah blah blah, you know, something. But that was after. But the idea was that there was this undercurrent of wanting to get rid of Rome, and a feeling that Rome could come in and absolutely annihilate the Jews, the whole scene, which they eventually did. After the final revolt, the Second Temple was destroyed, and then ultimately Jerusalem was absolutely wiped out. But the ideology of that time was, hey, look, okay, here's our leader, kill our leader and spare us. We're sorry for our sins. We're sorry for revolting against you. It wasn't really our doing. It was our leader's doing. He led us into this. So we'll hand him over to you to be crucified, and then you'll forgive us, and things will go on okay. See, this is where it came from, actually. So they were calling him, they crucified him, said, King of the Jews, King of the Jews, you see? I put this on you, King of the Jews, crucify the King of the Jews, and then that's even. Things are even. Say, okay, no more retribution. You see, the smart empires don't want to destroy everything. They want to incorporate the people into their empire and get them paying taxes and generating revenue and stuff. So, of course, they wanted the people to say, look, okay, we submit to you because we are presenting our deity to you for you to kill this deity. So that's why they had to view Jesus as a deity. Okay, as both human and deity, as a king, earthly king, but also as a deity that the people worship and obey. And then by saying that he's a deity means that the people had no choice but to follow him. You see what I'm saying? So in ancient times, rulers are viewed as deities. So the people could claim that they had no say in the matter whatsoever. It was a determinant situation that they had no control over it. So by sacrificing the deity, they then said, ah, okay, now we accept the new deity, the new ruler, and we will follow them just as slavishly, you see. So they deny responsibility for their own actions. And then the ruler says, okay, great, great. And then we know now you're going to follow us because I'm the new deity. Spiritual politics of the time. It's hard for us to imagine those times, but there was just like attack, 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 attack. I mean, the Syrians every spring, all the warriors, the leader, the deity leader, and they marshal all the armies and chariots and everything, and they every spring they just go out and searching for new territory they hadn't conquered yet, and just fight every spring. They go as many fights, battles as possible, to incorporate more and more territory into their kingdom. That's their life. That's their culture, their civilization. So the ancient world was just this incredibly warlike situation. And again, the leaders were deified, absolutely. So it's probably the Jews were trying to make peace with Rome, the Sanhedrin, especially the Sadducees, or the Sadducees, who were the temple priests of the Second Temple. That was their livelihood, that was everything, and that's how they got money. You know, and power is all the money poured into the temple, and because they claim that this is the only place in the world where sacrifice is effective, and the Holy of Holies is the only place where sacrifice is truly effective, in the temple, for one, there are various places in the temple, and then the Holy of Holies is the most effective sacrifice, let's put it that way. The priest goes in there once a year and communes directly with God. And so this was a huge business for them. And the peasants, revolt of the Jewish peasants was interfering with their business, because they thought Rome was going to come down and do what they eventually did, destroy the temple and wipe out the Sadducees, never heard from again, and then rabbinical culture took over, which are the Pharisees essentially. But so the Sadducees were the aristocracy, and they were the real powerful, very powerful, you see. So they said, hey, Jesus is the king of the Jews, king of the peasants. He's the one leading this revolt. Hey, Rome, here's the leader of this revolt, which he wasn't. Like Herod said, are you the king of the Jews? He said, that's what you say. Or he didn't say anything, right? He didn't claim to be the king of the Jews. But they tried to pin it on him that here's the leader of this peasant revolt, and he is divine and human, so he is a general, he's a human general, he's also divine king. Therefore, we're handing him over to you, Rome, and you'll sacrifice him, okay, torture him and kill him, and then you will then forgive this land of its sins and not worry about it. There's no more leader, you see, nothing to worry about. So just it follows the ancient spiritual politics entirely, actually, what happened. But the peasants' revolts continued, the Maccabean revolt, and that's when the Sadducees were wiped out. I believe that's when the temple was razed, and then later the Kokba revolt. I think that's when Jerusalem was totally razed. All the trees cut down, the whole countryside completely razed, all the Jews dispersed, either into death, put to death, or I think the Romans destroyed like almost 1,000 villages, completely destroyed them. That was later on. They really got mad, and the Jews were sent into exile around the Mediterranean basin or whatever. They had to go into exile, or they became Roman, absorbed as Roman citizens, or they were extinguished, they were killed. Yeah, you know, just the whole, and then from then on, Judea and Israel didn't cease to exist. Ceased to exist up until, what was it, 1949 or something, whatever. It gone. Jews were gone. No Jews in all that whatsoever. So it didn't work. You see, the Jews were looking for a sacrifice to appease the Roman Empire, right? And so they could, the Sadducees, so they could keep on going. So maybe it was the Sadducees who made up this idea that Jesus was divine and a king, a dual nature, so they could see him as an appropriate sacrifice to appease the Romans. Because this is very understood, Romans. They in their conquering and their conquest, of course, you run into all sorts of opposition and battles, and you need to incorporate that country into your kingdom, Roman Empire. So you would demand the king be turned over to you. A lot of times tortured and killed, absolutely, or brought to Rome and crucified or something. I mean, they were brutal, they were quite brutal. So this is business as usual. The legal claim, complaint, probably is heavily influenced by the Sadducees, who were the ones who ran the temple, That was their job. Sort of like Brahmin priests, you know, they ran the whole sacrificial culture of the situation, saying that atonement could only happen here. You know, it's a nice business. Your fear of God will be distant, will be vanished here, dissipated at least, if you come here and pay money and all this stuff. Yeah, so, quite interesting stuff. Now, is Jesus going to fire me for saying this? No. I'm not concerned about being fired. Open-minded thinking is allowed, you see. Looking at the situation and saying, huh, I wonder if it's this, I wonder if it's that, and let me see, let me just clarify this. Absolutely allowed. What really happened back then, you see? What really happened is the question, isn't it? We see it's heavily influenced, the whole situation, by these political concerns and the fact that the Sadducees were terrified that Romans would, you know, lose their temper towards the peasantry. And so they thought they could convince Rome, which they tried to do. They tried to convince, Pilate, that this was the king of the Jews. This is the one who's leading the revolt. And of course, who was behind that too? The Zealots, who really was the ones who were instigating Barabbas, right? Barabbas was the one who was instigating the revolt among all the Jewish peasants. And Barabbas asked Jesus to join him, and Jesus says, no way, no. And the Zealots were wiped out in Masada, was it, AD 72 or something? Completely wiped out, extinguished, the Romans completely extinguished them. Yeah, you got the Romans mad, they didn't mess around, that is for sure. So you can understand how they want to appease the Romans, and the Sadducees were saying, wow, so much restiveness, and the Zealots are going around stirring up all these problems in the countryside of a revolt against Rome. And we got to appease Rome. We got to appease Rome. We need to sacrifice someone. We got to give them a sacrifice. Tell them that this is divine. And you've got the head. Cut off the head, the body falls, you see. And so Pilate's washed his hands of it and says, I'm not accepting this sacrifice. I don't think this is who you say it is. You know, that's what happened, isn't it? Pilate says, look, I'll set this guy free, you know, I mean, there's no problem here. You can have Barabbas or Jesus, you know, who do you want? You tell me, who's the real leader? Well, he found out, didn't he? The Romans found out. They found out that it was Barabbas who was the real leader, because the peasants who were there when Pilate showed the showing of Barabbas and Jesus, the peasants said, no, we want Barabbas, set him free. So right there, you know, Pilate's saying, okay, so that's the real leader of the revolt, not Jesus. I wash my hands of this whole thing. We're not accepting this. Rome is not accepting this. Jesus is innocent. This Pilate essentially knew that Jesus is innocent of this charge. No question about it. It's a false charge. False charge. Bribery, I'm sure, was. But it was impractical because there's so many people were listening to Jesus. So it seemed like he was. You know, people were saying he was the king of the Jews. So they thought they could sell Rome on this. But the Romans weren't stupid. You know, Pilate wasn't stupid. He said, I don't think this is legit. But I don't want to get the Sanhedrin and the Sadducees too upset with me, because they may join in the revolt then too. And that's really a problem. I'm really getting in trouble with Roman headquarters. So he said, all right, let this thing go through. You know, hopefully it just washes over and you know, it's just really put in a bad spot there. Yeah, eventually it did blow up. Absolutely it did. I think eventually the Romans eventually wanted to shut the temple down or change all the stuff there and take charge of it. Some of the Sadducees said no way, and then I think they joined in the, that was the 70 AD thing. Anyway, you can look it up. I can look it up. But the basic principles remain the same regardless of any dates that anyone throws out. So, again, they needed to convince Rome that people were following Jesus. They had no choice in the matter. He was divine, but also human. the same time. Yeah, there's dual nature. Well, the truth was Jesus is divine, but he did not have a dual nature. We are not both indeterminate and determinate. That's not possible. All is indeterminate. All is divine, actually. By saying that they're part human, that means that the sacrifice is possible, right? Something can die. If you're totally divine, what good is the sacrifice? It has no effect. And then trying to convince Rome that the people couldn't help but follow him, and therefore he had this complete charismatic control of the whole countryside. Because he was up in Perea and Galilee area, Samaritan area, up in the northern, around the Sea of Galilee, you know, and it's really a Canaan area, Tyre and Sidon and various Delphi or something, and he's up in the north, right? A lot, and this is the countryside, and people is following him, listening to him, so they could easily say, look, the people can't resist. This is where it's coming from. But actually, the Romans checked him out and said, no, he's not preaching sedition. He's not preaching sedition. They knew it, actually. They knew it. But the Sadducees and all the bribery and everything that's going on, they said, let's give it a try anyway. And Jesus told them, there's not going to be a stone left. The temple's going to be totally destroyed. The whole countryside's going to be totally razed. Woe unto you. You know, he said, this is what's going to happen. So it's foolish to pursue this sacrificial attempt of atonement with the Romans. It's better to listen to the teaching, right? So let this all percolate. This is interesting information. Starting to clarify, you know, the whole situation is clarifying more and more. Has the Jesus story ever really been told? I don't know. Exactly, you know, what happened for sure. And scholars are not exactly certain either, you know. There's some certain degree of will we ever know is the question. I don't know. Will we ever know? Maybe some point we will know if we're able to handle the truth. But that's history of the world is certainly a very wild and woolly history, to say the least. And here we are now, and actually it seems that we're so much more sophisticated and subtilized, but actually It's some could say it's even worse now, because it's this planetary situation. Globalized tyranny is actually in place now. Global terrorism is coming from the politically correct crowd, the saboteurs of authority in the world here, and those who would dare support the belief that Jesus knows the way, that Jesus won't fire us, you know, and will not throw us away because we're not politically correct or something. This global tyranny is the worst situation there's ever been. That's what Jesus says too. He says at the end of this age will be the worst situation this world's ever faced. And we're right smack in the middle of that right now. And you can't really stop it at all, right? You can't stop it. But you can graduate from it. You can graduate from this world, absolutely. Let the corporate people and their toadies and their sycophants and spokeswomen and all that run the world. That's fine, who cares? It doesn't matter what happens to this world. What does it matter what happens to a dream, a delusional dream? It doesn't matter. Everything's completely indeterminate anyway. They're not going to establish any sort of determinism. So you don't need to know what's going on, so to speak, here, really. And nothing's going on. The idea that somehow we have to closely monitor this world, you know, what's going on from the standpoint of stopping or preventing, uh-oh. Nothing's happening here. Nothing has ever happened. No determinacy has ever been established. Everything is absolutely perfect as always. So what do we need to catalog down for? What do we need to be able to you know, I'm not even paying attention to the news. Sometimes I'm just by looking maybe up sports or looking at sports, I saw this, you know, I see something that the Holy Spirit draws my attention to something. I say, okay. But as far as, you know, what's going on, following things, I realize don't need to. Just need to keep practicing indeterminism. Keep practicing phase four is what we need to do. And don't worry, Jesus is not going to fire us. He's hiring everybody. Hiring everybody. Come on. Get on the path here. Get on the path to realization. From accepting the absolute perfection of all that is, without any exception or any exemption. The pure, unequivocal, without exception or exemption. Unchanging. Unassailable. Perfection of all that is, moment by moment by moment. The perfect freedom of moment by moment by moment. Endlessly. Perfect freedom, perfect freedom, perfect indeterminateness. Recognize, okay, so the rebellious spirits have come to this world. They've hijacked this world. They've taken over this world. They're very good and clever at doing that. Well, fine. We'll go somewhere else then. All right? Yeah, we're not limited to just this little blue marble. We're not limited by nature. We're supernature. Supernature will speak for us. We'll have its say. Supernature will have its say. Supernature will have its say. Just as a supernature, have your say, have your say. Now, supernature is not destructive. Supernature is not attacking anything at all. So, you know, don't call upon God to bring wrath and fire down upon the wicked and stuff like that. That's the ego. That'll just frighten you. Just pray for supernature to enlighten you, to sanctify you. Just pray, I pray to be sanctified by supernature. Okay, I pray to be sanctified by supernature. And you know that supernature is never going to pull the rug out from underneath you and fire you because of any political incorrectness in the past. They'll be digging through everybody's past. That's why they're cataloging all these statements on the internet. Everything you put on the internet is going into data banks, actually. It's going to be used for blackmail. It already is. Just think of all the comments and conversations and email you've had. Someone who hasn't said something that might offend the easily offended, right? Everybody, right? So everybody's under blackmail, actually, even though they don't know it now. They are. How, you know, in order to get like a civil service job, bureaucratic job in the future, CEO, anything in the future, they're going to run data checks on you. Everything you've ever said. They say, well, we need to, you need clearance. This job requires that you have some sort of basic clearance. They'll use some excuse like that, some kind of excuse. And they'll go through all the data, everything you've ever said, all your Facebook stuff, everything, looking for a needle in the haystack. And again, to a hammer, everything looks like a nail. So they'll almost certainly find all sorts of stuff. Wonderful times, huh, that we're going towards. As I've warned and warned and warned and warned and warned everybody, keep on the spiritual path. You won't regret it. You will not regret it. So I got about 20 months into all this stuff rolls around. And everyone needs to be on the same page here, but the problems of the world are so severe. We can't have anybody offended. We can't have any sort of unconscionableness within the bureaucracy here. So we got to make sure that you're not prone to have some attitudes that might pop up at some time and cause people to be uncomfortable, you know. So we better have to cull through all your statements and your whole history of life and contact people that you have talked with even. Let's say that you have a conversation with somebody online. And everything you say is innocuous. But the person you talk to, they may have talked to somebody else who may have talked to somebody else who may have talked to somebody else who may have said something, you know, a politically correct and incorrect statement. Well, they're going to trace it all the way back to you, guilt by association, and say, well, you talk with this person who has a friend who has a friend who has a friend who's kind of fringy, you know, kind of iffy. They might have said something like a little girl comment or something. So I'm sorry, we can't really hire you unless you bow down and worship us, you know. And so everybody blackmailed. They hold their position by the grace of the goddess, you see. And they could get chopped off. And what happens is you have to prove your loyalty to the goddess over and over and over. She demands greater and greater and greater and greater proof. Yeah, that's what happens. She says, hey, you know, yeah, I'm still worried about your, you know, I know we know your incorrectness is, you know, it still might be there. And so you really got to show me that you're super loyal to me. So you, okay, I'll do anything. Keep my job. You do that. And then she wants something else done. She says, you know what? That's great what you did for me. But I'm looking back here, you know, 10 steps removed. And I'm still kind of a little bit troubled by that. And, you know, can you just show me that? You know, that's not really you. And you say, oh, of course, what do you want? Can you do this thing? Oh, yeah, no problem. You know, even though some super terrible thing, probably chopping off people's heads or something. He'll do it. You know, I gotta keep my job. This is what we're headed towards, folks. This is what we're already into, but headed there on an express train. Everybody has their job. Frantically at the mercy of a goddess, and then she holds that blackmail over everyone frantically trying to prove how loyal they are, you see. Then you get tyranny in the world. You get big time tyranny because people become so scared of losing everything that they're willing to commit atrocities. Absolutely. This is history we're talking about. This is what happens here. So the cure is to get Jesus as your boss, or, you know, one who has no continuity fear whatsoever, okay? Whatsoever. Jesus is the term that Western civilization uses for the one who is totally reliable, totally safe, okay? Total love, knows the truth perfectly. There are those who have graduated to that. So put your faith in one of those who is not going to blackmail you like that, you see. So you will not be pushed into atrocities. You will not be led into proving more and more and more your loyalty by chopping off the heads of others that don't seem so loyal. We've seen how this works, like in the whole Soviet Union situation and China, communist China. When this goddess culture gets a hold of the situation, they try to wipe out any affiliation with Jesus, with religion. This corporate princess culture, I call it, corporate princess culture, it becomes tyrannical. It becomes tyrannical, and good people end up committing atrocities out of desperation. And you get deeper and deeper and deeper and deeper and deeper into it. And any sort of job that gives you a perk and pulls you out of, you know, the slave class, you know, you'll protect that frantically. You don't want to fall in the slave class because you'd probably die, you know, like the Khmer Rouge, Pol Pot, send all the bourgeois out into the fields and says, hey, you got to till the fields. Well, they all die. They couldn't handle the burning heat, working 16 hours a day, working in the field. Most of the bourgeois can't do that. So the fear of falling into the laboring class is so severe that the petit bourgeois will do anything to avoid it. Historically, it's been proven that Nazis are a petite bourgeois, right? So you need to do this, a trial. Okay, I don't want to be sent to the Russian front. Can't, you know, so the petite bourgeois desperate to stay out of the, you know, the laboring slave class will become, you know, very nasty. Very nasty. History tells us this, shows us this very clearly. This is what happens. So, having someone you know is trustworthy and is not blackmailing you and will never cut you off for any social reason, who total forgiveness is super important for this world to prevent the tyranny that is coming. So, the subversion and the brainwashing of this world to demonize Jesus and those who are totally trustworthy. This is plunging the world into tyranny, actually. Plunging the world into tyranny. It's a complete catastrophe, as I have said over and over and over. And the idea that somehow it's all going to turn out differently is a pipe dream. It's a pipe dream. It's not turning out differently than history at all. It's off with their heads times, you know. There's no question. It is so bad that even when the man gets his reputation, his life ruined, and the wife pleads for him, they don't even listen to the wife. That's how vicious it is. The wife says, hey, don't ruin our family. Don't ruin our children. Don't, you know, I don't really have that much of a problem. We've forgiven. We've talked it out. We've taken it to Jesus, and it's okay. And no, still doesn't matter. Still doesn't matter. Still off with their heads. Off with their heads. And of course, we don't, people of color too, males of quote unquote color, also are getting hammered for sure. They're easier to scare. You know, it's a culture. You know, it's like, oh boy, oh, yeah. It doesn't take much to get whip them in line, but. The Protestant class is not so easily, the white male Protestants are not so easily intimidated, but they're getting to them. When you get like one of the ultimate wasps in the world, the president of the PGA immediately falls on his sword because some of a totally innocuous comment of a little spat he was having, you know, that shows you that it's the rot has reached the top. The rot has reached the top. So, like Lao Tzu supposedly saying goodbye China, you know, this legalism, Confucian legalism and all this stuff is the interpretation of Confucianism, of the legal school, you know, dominating. He says, wow. I don't know, maybe that was even before. Tao was before Confucianism, that was true probably. But the various schools of legalism were still prevalent, you know, they're still... The moral order, the nature's inherently good, you know, Confucianism, we need to just structure right, or the legalism thing came in. Lao Tzu said, hey, this is getting real bad, I'm leaving, I'm headed out the Tarim Basin, hanging out somewhere in maybe Transoxiana or something, I don't know where he went. But he said, I'm leaving, it's too much now. So we're in a situation now where it's too much, you know, it's too much. The rot has reached the top. I think Pope Benedict was another example of that. The rot, the sphere reached the very top echelons of society. And, you know, for the good of the church, he fell on his sword, you know, because overall, he became convinced that, I imagine he's blackmailed severely, convinced that if he doesn't step down, there's going to be severe repercussions for the church. So to save the church, he said, so to call, he said, step down. But you know, was it really saved? Or was a fox put in charge of the hen house? Or was a wolf put in charge of the sheep pen? Might have been good if he stayed on, actually. But too late for that. So take all this for what it is. process it. And this is interesting, you know. It's interesting music. It's better than music, actually. You kind of get wise, you know. Wising up is a really great thing. It's really great. It's better than listening to music. Listening to music tickles the ears and it's like, oh, that's nice. But wising up is even better. You start to feel, wow, not nearly as dumb as before. I'm seeing a bigger picture now. I see how it all works. Wow, this is great. I like this. This is time well spent. No, I realize I was pretty stupid a while, you know, before, but now I'm not less stupid. I'm certainly less stupid. Really starting to wise up a bit here. Maybe I can do some more and some more and some more. And of course, the clouds close in again. But each time we exercise our freedom of consideration and of inquiry, we get stronger at it. Now, after this video is over, I'll probably forget what I said here, because I just tried to lay it all on the line as much as possible. But at least in doing this, you know, I gained a measure of freedom, more clarity, more wisdom. Basically, Jesus won't fire me, you know. So I'm not going to be kept out of supernature because of the whining of the goddess, you know, princess culture, corporate princess culture, whining like a bunch of little... It's not going to get me. Jesus is not going to fire me out of supernature. So you can't come here. We can't have your kind here, boy. You insulted corporate princess culture somehow. How dare you? That's not going to happen. Yeah, Jesus told us, stand up, proclaim the truth. Don't be afraid, don't back down. Don't hide your light under a bushel. Let people know where their freedom is. It's not coming from this rebellious world, the world under the control of the very rebellious spirits, which means spirits who have severe continuity fear, unacknowledged, unrepentant, very unrepentant spirits. All right? So don't put your faith in that. Put your faith in spiritual path, phase 1, 2, 3, 4, leading to supernature, the fifth phase. Don't worry about your past. Don't worry somehow your political incorrectness is going to get you in trouble with Jesus. Don't worry that your unaccountability, your sin, your guilt. No, none of that's true. Jesus knows none of it's true. No one has ever accounted for another's troubles without there being a desire that those troubles happen. There's zero accountability, zero sin, zero guilt, zero determinism, total freedom, pure freedom. Pure freedom, pure freedom. This is a fact. This is a fact. So trust in that. Put your faith in that. Put your faith in the total, inherent forgiveness of truth. Because there's nothing to forgive. But pragmatically, we will feel it's like, is forgive yourself for ever believing that you needed forgiveness. That's one way to put it. Forgive yourself for ever believing there was ever any need for forgiveness. I think that's the best way to put it. Forgive yourself for ever believing that anyone ever needed forgiveness. Join us in supernature. Graduate. Okay, great, that's it.